thanks for coming. Absolute transparency in all things. This is today.
Smile, Neil.
So,
Neil, before we start, we just lent some paper or something.
Sorry, I just hadn't had time to.
I have some. It's okay, we have paper here.
Thank you very much. Oh, we have it here.
Sorry. No, you have this as well. You will have it. So, super duper extra busy. Come in. Today is a. One day I'm going to be all smooth. One day I'm going to go, yes, welcome. For those people who couldn't make it last week.
Good
try. I've been sounding on to it for a long time. There probably is going to be a couple of people popping in halfway through, so we'll just crack on. So, again, thanks for coming. Today's about like. Following on from last week, which was the no part, it's kind of interesting. I've been doing quite a lot of learning this week, utilising the process. I've got an international photographer client, and he was, it's one of the top 50 in the world, isn't it? I'm going to claim credit for that. I have nothing to do with his natural ability, than for me, obviously. So, and we were looking at his product, his product funnel, and matching it onto the, you know, the funnel, the triangle thing. And for its kind of first real outing in a high-risk situation, completely works. So, I'm going to quickly recap what we did last week, just to kind of touch on it again, so everybody, you can relax, don't worry, there's no learning going to happen in the next 5 minutes. You can just breathe. Promise, we're just gonna recover some familiar stuff and everyone's going to be happy. If anyone needs to go off to their safe and happy place, just stare out the window, it's still quite sunny. So, today, this is what today's going to look like, which is a little bit of a review. And the bits I've broken it into is, I've looked at the science of being liked. Okay? So there's the stuff we can do within us, and there's the stuff we can do for other people. And then there's a couple of golden rules that glue those two bits together. So, first hour or 50 minutes is going to be around a review and the bits we can do, like behaviours. Most of today is about behaviours. And because it's kind of from behavioural psychology, it ask questions, you'll be really helping. Ask questions if it doesn't seem absolutely clear. Ask questions about how to apply it to your business, because that'd be really useful for me. So if it doesn't, obviously it's going to be seamless and the learning is going to be slip into your ears like gold or silk and just be easy to do. But if there's any problems, I'm just knocking around because I'm nervous with this. Right. So we're going to do us, then we're going to do what we do with other people, and then we're going to look at the overarching thing at the end. So everybody knows me. Yeah. So there were a couple of new people who booked online. Fuckers didn't show up. So, I've included this. What is this? What is no like, trust, buy? I've had a distinction or two in the last week. What I've realised is there's three fundamental principles to it. One is doing business on purpose. And this kind of hit me like a thunderbolt the other day. Because what we do is if I just do this, then something will happen. If I just do this, then something will happen. If I just do this, then something will happen. Fucking doing it on purpose, making clear decisions about, okay, for the next month, I'm going to do this. Yeah? And that way, you can assess what happens. It's like, Bilal's really good at doing little experiments with his health and his body. He's forever getting his top off on camera, online. He is shameless. Shameless. Then again, if my stomach was that flat, I'd be naked all the time.
I've worked hard on this. Mine was bigger than yours at the start of the year.
Exactly. Yeah. So, and it's about doing it on purpose, experimenting, setting little goals, and experimenting for the next week or the next month. The second principle that I've identified this week is this: all marketing is just a conversation. No story, no magic, no bells and whistles. one more thing is just a conversation. And like a conversation, it has two sides. Listening is the most important bit, and it's about providing value. And the good thing about conversation, good thing about conversation is that value happens between people. So, you know, happens somewhere in the middle, not. So, all marketing is conversation, and ta-da, all business is a relationship. Okay, so none of this is rocket science. I'm not saying I'm inventing any of this, but this is just the stuff I've been really thinking about this week. And this is where this kind of like comes from, is that in kind of business terms, if we want to increase our sales, we need to A, improve the relationship that we have with our existing customers. B, find new people to talk to. You know, just like if I wanted to make new friends or improve my friendshipness, I'd either come round your houses and make myself a little bit of a nightmare for a bit, or find somebody else to bother for a while. You know, same thing in business. So, this has really helped me put it in the right place this week. So, for those people who weren't here last week, and for those people who were, want a little bit of a recap. The notion of deliberateness is about creating in business terms, about creating a marketing funnel. Yeah, so that we've got everybody here who doesn't know about us, and the idea of marketing is to get to one single buyer with some cash who goes, purchase now, please. And there are four stages of the relationship that you need to go through. I'm going to charge everybody who's taking photographs of my IP. Yeah. You can, just credit me, please.
They were actually just taking photographs of you, Neil.
So, don't tempt me.
You might think I've got a view last, I've got nothing at the screen.
Good. So the way this happens is a four-stage process called know, like, trust, buy. Yeah? The know is what you do. The know is how you, the like is how you do it, the trust is why you do it, and the buy is your clear value-driven offer. Interestingly, these are different price points as well. Yeah, the purpose of marketing is to take people from here, over there. Your social tends to be at the know and like bit because it's much easier to throw out a big load of information about what you do and how you do it, and then you attract people back to your website where you have a more intense conversation, and then that's where you're making of an offer, because putting the purchase over here is, as we were saying last week, a little bit inappropriate. Wedding dress, first date. So, is everybody okay with that? Okay, things that we touched on last week, just to recap, about the no thing was about creating a compelling brand. And by compelling brand, I mean have you guys understanding what your brand values were. Yeah? Are, even. What your brand values are. Why should I do business with you? Yeah? What's in it for me? What's the experience you're providing? And then how do you brand that experience? Yeah? There's a reason why I always wear the same stuff. There's a reason why I'm really sweary. There's a reason why. Because that's the experience I can guarantee every time. And anybody who's known me for a little length of time, I'm always the same. Whether it's Tuesday morning or whether I'm delivering, I'm always the same. I'm a nightmare to work with in the office. Hiya.
Hiya. What is this happening in here today?
I've got it for the next 4 weeks.
I've got a lady in the reception area.
Okay.
And she was looking for an event that's happening today.
Probably my
wife.
No light, trust, buy, turn strangers into customers. Thank you very much.
She has been here on time, which I wasn't sure, I didn't know it was in here.
I just sent her in. Thank you very much indeed.
Let's all
hide. Yeah. Sorry. Spot the meanie in the room. This is the hilarious thing, so I tell everybody I'm the nice one usually, because I'm all sweary and wavy. People think they're bollocks, and it's true, I am, aren't you? And it's the horrible. Come in. No need to, it's alright, no rush. Just, sorry, my dear. I thought reception knew, come in.
I was going slightly mad. Sorry.
We're just recapping what we did last week. So. Oh. me my wavy arms. That's going to be fun. And remind me at the break to change the batteries in this, please. I don't have any working memory due to some poor personal choices in the early 80s. So, recapping what we did last week, the no part of it is about what do we do, what can we do for other people. So, creating a compelling brand, what do we do, and how do we do that? What's the experience we can deliver every single time? And one of the things we were talking about last week is that, okay, I could pretend to be all calm and quiet, I could pretend to be all kind of reasonable, and I could get away with that for a short period of time, but that would kill me because it's not really me. And your brand should be built on who you are as people, yeah, about your key values as people. Because then you can run with it, then it becomes something amazing, and then you can kind of really, really kind of get some value out of it. Then the next bit we did was designing your ideal customer, which is the answer to one of my most hated questions in marketing is, who's your customer?
Oh, everyone.
Fuck off. It's not. So I'm a bit sweary, sorry. You can in this week.
It's alright, I've met you before.
Oh, that's alright. I am a little bit sweary.
And still she came.
Indeed, and still she came. So.
It was a compelling brand.
Yeah, indeed, yeah. See? Branding in action. Exactly. So, who do you want to work with? That whole kind of, just get a message out there. It's bullshit, it didn't work. Tampon advert, remember? Guys, I have no idea. No. Because this is not, the message isn't right, isn't relevant, doesn't meaning. So just get it out there. You're wasting your time and money. Choose who. And then, go to their house if necessary. Who was it? I was at an event once and they'd spent like some hundreds of pounds on marketing this event. And they only had like four or five people in the audience. So much so that when you chopped it up, their marketing spend versus visitor, they could have afforded to just go, hiya, do you want to come? Right, we'll send a taxi. Rather than marketing. I was noticing that when you think about it like that, if your marketing spend is more expensive than a personal taxi for everyone here, you're not doing something right. So, decide who. And there was, you know, kind of, there's a little worksheet with six different holes for you to fill in about demographics, psychographics, values, that kind of thing, and you could build a picture from that. And then leveraging their dreams and goals. Everyone in this room, unless you're dead from the neck up, you have dreams and goals. You do, promise. If I wanted to sell you anything, I would then use those dreams and goals to sell you the thing. Yeah? If it's about travel, oh, this will help you to travel more. If it's about personal development, what I'm selling you will help you to build your personal development. If it's about, I don't know, find a new partner. This will make you much more attractive to the opposite sex. Yeah? If you leverage their dreams and goals, winner. And then we talked a little bit about discretionary versus strategic money. Yeah? If you can tell people that what they're spending now will help them succeed later on, much more likely to buy it than if it's just, oh, just spare it, it's pocket money. Yeah? So make it strategic for that. Last bit, creating an offer that people want to buy. Understanding what you do, who for, and how. Customer value proposition. Yeah, very simple. All big corporations use it. Understand why they should give a shit about what you're selling. Yeah, good. And then when you do make the offer, make it 90% what, 10% how. Yeah, so what it'll do, it'll make you much more attractive to the opposite sex. How? Well, it'll make your skin more glowy and it'll make you smell like toffee. Whatever that is. It will do more of that. So concentrate on the impact rather than the weight of the impact. Like, everyone got that? Everyone okay? Hey, come in. You'll have to drag a chair in from out there.
Hello.
Snuggly. Good work. So, back to light. This builds on all of that work. So I hope you've done loads of homework preparing yourself for this on last week's work so you all know exactly what you're talking about. Liars! Fucking liars! Yes, we haven't thought about it at all. We just kind of came along, had a little bit of a laugh, the knob gags, and then they went home again. Good, okay. So, this is today. We're going to start with the 5 myths of business relationships. Which is... most business people are full of shit. And I'm going to show you why. Then we're going to do the us bit, which is about being yourself, being congruent to who yourself is, and then being tasty. I'll describe tasty in a little bit. We'll then do the them bit, which is the magic of questions, power of listening, birds of a feather principle, and never a taker. Although I think I've called it something else a little bit later on. I told you it's very new. And then the last bit is the 2 golden rules. There were 3, but the 3rd one wasn't very golden, so I changed. So, it's true. This is the way the world works. So, 5 myths of business relationships. Ready? This probably isn't going to take longer than I thought. But, first one. Well, they're so obvious, and you're all going to grab it dead easy. Is that the relationship is about the transaction. Right? Is that you meet people, hi, how can they help my business? Who do they know that I know? I'm going to look at them on LinkedIn to see who their contacts are, so I can then get them to leverage it. Can you introduce me to Dave? Can you do... Yeah? That's not why we have relationships. The relationship's in the back, it's in the connection, the permanent. The relationship is about the connection. It's about making friends. It's about on a human level. This whole business to business and business to consumer is bullshit. It's person to person. Who's ever done business with a big company? Okay, you've done business with a big company. Did you walk up to the building and talk to the building?
No.
Who did you talk to there?
A person.
A person, exactly. Big business is all about one person talking to another person. It's never B2B, B2C. It's just people talking to people. And this is the connection. It's about the human connection you make with another living human. So, it's not about the transaction, because does anybody like being pumped for information? You know, when somebody sits down and goes, oh, tell me about this, and how does that work? It's all right egotistically when you're kind of going, oh, yeah, no vote, thank you very much. But after a while, it's just like, do you want the number? Just call them. Because it's not nice being feeling like you're an information ATM. Because you're not... It's not about the connection at that point, it's about the transaction.
I've gone down on a recruitment consultant doing that, so he's trying to get me to teach him his job.
Yeah, exactly. I get that a lot. Absolutely. I got a mail on LinkedIn the other day going, hiya, I'm out of ideas. You look like you have a lot. Would you mind sharing some with me?
How long is a piece of string to ask?
It's that long. But, that. What? Don't even say what kind of idea, just, can you improve my life, please? Yeah, probably, but I'm not gonna. So, relax. Stop. It's a kind of zen thing. If you're trying to do something, then you're missing the point. Yeah? Yeah. It's about people. Just listen. That's the thing. And all of this is about likability. You know, it's not about being the most successful Harvard business MBA, it's about likability, about getting people to like who you are and what you do. Okay? So, depending on your business goals, if you don't mind being the Cruella de Vil of Lancashire and in your little Dalmatian coat, mwahaha, I love Cruella de Vil, excuse me. If you're okay with being Cruella de Vil,
I have the wig and everything. I make Dalmatian tails.
Yeah, wig. Yeah. There are dogs going missing in your area. So, not round you, you don't. Exactly. So
that's a
man working here, thank you very much. So it's not about the transaction, it's about the connection. Yeah? So, myth 2. Business relationships are built on professionalism. Does anybody come from a career where they're told they have to be professional?
Everybody does. We all get taught all that bullshit.
It is nonsense. Because real relationships are built on being genuine. and professional is being not genuine. Professional is being fake, effectively. It's sanding off the corners of your actual personality to fit in. As soon as anybody tells me, this is why I don't work at UCLan anymore.
Because you wouldn't put on a tie.
The reason why I started wearing the black shirts and things was just to piss Peter off. Because he told me I had to wear slacks and a shirt. Just started dressing like Johnny Cash. totally works. He tried to have a sack 4 times. Anyway, but...
Just because of your dress?
No, or many other reasons. I'll tell you later. Built on professionalism, this all kind of... You seem like...
No, I was just... Is that because of... our now modern interpretation of professionalism, do you think?
I think the world has changed. There's a reason why people don't sell shampoo with scientists anymore. Tell me more, Neil. I will. Even 15 years ago, you would have people in white coats going, here's the chemicals in your shampoo, and this is why it's very good for you. Now, what you've got is people in their own bathroom going, oh, this is great. This is fantastic. Oh, it smells fantastic.
Joe Harvard football.
Exactly, but they're not scientists, right? They're people just like us.
Yeah? I bet he doesn't use them, Charles.
No, of course he doesn't. He's got a ball anyway. And his name's Charles. Okay, his name isn't even Joe Hart, his name's Charles.
Charles Hart.
Yeah. Anyway, carry on. So.
He's posh. Have you not heard him speak? Have you heard Frank Lampard speak? He's from a public school.
The only time I heard Joe Hart speak was when he was asking that ball.
No, posh like him.
Carry on. So, the whole thing about professionalism is that we don't trust authority anymore. Yeah, society, we don't. Look at today, the MPs are giving themselves 10% wage rise, backdated for months, even though the rest of the public sector is on 1%. So, we don't trust authority, therefore, we're a little bit more relaxed around professionalism. You know, it doesn't matter. I don't trust anybody in a suit. I don't trust anybody in a suit at all. Just because they're wearing a suit. What does that tell you about them? Is that they're more concerned with appearing in a certain way than being themselves. And anybody who isn't being themselves, don't care.
Branson hates suits.
Yeah.
You've got to ask the question, though. What happens
you don't like them.
What happens if their personality is... I feel comfortable in a suit. Yeah.
Good, then that's fantastic.
But if you don't,
but they're
going
to have to cope with the fact that I don't trust them.
That's a shame.
Nah.
Because it's like making a judgment on someone very quickly, based on one piece of information.
Yeah, we all do it.
Yeah, I know, but we all do it. But you try and be aware you're doing it.
I embrace it.
And it's that mistrust I would find a shame.
I just embrace it. The thing is that I work very quickly, I work very fast. And the thing, I know who I'm genuinely going to get on with. Mm. If I spend time, tell me a little bit more about yourself, then that's me not being me.
But do you?
So in order for them to be themselves, I would have to not be me. Yes. This relationship is doomed to failure, because we're both not.
But do you ever go back and just question and think, do you know, my first impression was I'm not going to get on with them, but actually, do you know, I was wrong?
Sometimes. It happens rarely. But generally, if you meet people more than once, you see more than one side of them.
Yeah.
You know, so it grows over time, but generally, on first impression, I generally don't. Personally, you are all free to trust people in suits. By the way, I'm not suggesting that you.
I suppose it comes back to your previous point about that connection.
Yeah.
And that initial connection that you want to work with, and for you, people in suits are not necessarily the people you want.
I'll qualify that actually. Thank you for that point. Qualify that. If it's a Vivienne Westwood suit, or something that is absolute dripping in Diamante, or looking fabulous. Completely get it. If it's something from Greenwoods off the bargain rail that they've not looked after, as I'll tell you what. So, there's suits and suits and suits. You know. So, myth.
They might tell you that they're as uncomfortable with suits as you are.
Exactly. So that's why I don't bother. Myth three is that you need a reason to connect. It's like,
teacher this in marketing at uni.
Yeah, it's balls. Absolute nonsense.
So bloody corporate.
Exactly. And it kind of leaks into social. It's like one of the greatest myths in LinkedIn is like, oh, you only want to connect with people who are related to your career. And really, why?
Bollocks.
Exactly. It's called networking. That's like saying I'm going to go to a business network and only talk to people I know. It's balls. The whole idea is to just reach out and connect. You don't need connection. Is the purpose of connection? There's no ultimate thing, and it's, you get that a lot with people who are like, you know, these compulsive networkers.
Cheers.
No. But you're an actual person, Bilal, though. You know what I mean? You go because you like people.
Yeah.
There's a certain person at Northern Lights who shall remain nameless, but his name is Matt. He goes to networking events and just goes to groups of people and goes, can you just pass those cards around, please? He's hands piles of business cards to people and expect them to do the hard work. You're going to listen to him? Because he's not thinking about the connection. He's thinking about, well, maybe that's business. But they're going to do the hard work and track me down. Missing the point. The point is connection. The reason why you're all here is because we had a connection at some point. Yeah? You thought, oh, that was quite funny, or can't believe he's like that all the time, or what a dick, let's see what he does next. You know what I mean? Yeah. And that connection, that's where everything grows from. It's the shit from which your roses grow. You know, that kind of connection. It's the earthy, human part. So you need a purpose to connect. You don't need to connect. You don't. Connection is the purpose. This is why your elevator pitch is bollocks. If anybody's got an elevator pitch, give up. Unless you're doing a deliberate pitch thing.
What is an
elevator pitch is like a human advert, right? Old style business people say, you need an elevator pitch, this is what you need. And what it is pre-qualifying people to talk to, where you have a kind of little value statement. Hi, what I do is value statement for some people, blah, blah, blah. And then you watch and see if you go, oh, I'm interested in that.
Do you know what, though? We did the Lancashire Boost, and it was hammered into us, yeah. And we had to do it, and it was very like, I'm a robot. Yeah. But now, forgetting it, because we haven't had to stand and perform it, it does become a more natural. So now if someone puts you on the spot, I can now say it without having to think, but it's me saying it now rather than a robot.
What I mean is that, be human. Hi, yeah. What do you do? We make great badges out of reclaimed wood.
But it was good at the time to focus us on what we're actually doing. Mm. So it's evolved from that.
Indeed it has. I personally hate them.
Yeah.
Because of that. Because about the purpose for connection. About pre-qualifying the people that you want to talk to.
But I think for me, it took the panic out of people going, what do you do? And now I can just tell them. Okay. Although I don't do it as...
Yeah. It's different, you have a conversation now, though, which is better. It's no longer a pitch.
Yeah.
I think that's the thing, that when it's a pitch, you're not being human, you're selling at that point. Yeah. And you're looking to see if it lands, to see if you want to talk to them anymore. Oh, you're not interested? Okay, try.
My aim is to get them on LinkedIn or Facebook.
Yeah. Exactly.
That's my aim.
Yeah, so where you can
and then
have
I get them to dance, because that's what I do.
And then have a conversation. Yeah. So, myth four. Myth four, it's about you or them, right? That, you know, it's about what you're getting from the conversation or what they're getting from the conversation. It's not. It's about the relationship. The purpose is to build a relationship, not to profit separately. Yeah? It's about how you get to know each other, about how you get to... Yeah, how you get to know each other. I can't really say any... But this, the details you know about them, the personality, how, you know what I mean? The fact that I loved actually having a chat with you for the first time on Tuesday because you laughed so much and I really want to find out more about you going and living with goats in Portugal. Really want to know. Interesting lady. Yeah.
Did you follow?
Want to find out. But that awesome. You don't get that with an elevator pitch.
Yeah, that's true.
You don't get it. Yeah. So it's about the relationship. And, you know, I want to... create relationships with everybody in the room, like real ones, not just, hi, come to my stuff. I have no interest in that. What I want is to get to know you as people and find out more about you and see how we can help both each other and then how you can help the people I know. Easy. Myth five, I love this one. Myth five, you can make people like you if you play nice.
Bollocks.
Thank you very much. You beat me to the punch there. It is utter and complete bollocks.
I've never fitted in. Not everybody's ever liked me.
Well,
no one's ever liked you.
I said not everybody. Okay.
Nice isn't nice. Nice isn't real. Nice is professional. Nice is beige. Nice is, you know, gold. Nice is. So, you can't make people like you. Like, if you're trying to, people smell it. You know that, well, nice enough, but, you know, there's nothing behind his eyes, or the smile doesn't go up his face, or, you know what I mean? It's just...
No, it's false. You just said you can tell it's false.
Yeah, exactly. And it's like, okay, well...
The method in Keeley.
Sorry?
The method in Keeley.
Yeah. But you know what I mean? It's one of those things that, if you're going to do business, and if I'm going to give you money, or if you want me to give you money, be real. Because it improves the percentage chance of that happening. Because
what do you think about, you know, all the work that's been done about insights, personality profiling, and changing your behaviour to step into the customer's shoes and talking in their language? And what's your thoughts on that?
NLP.
NLP, isn't it, essentially?
It depends. If you think about... There's a bit with you and them, okay? There's a bit where all of that crosses over, even with the technique. And if you're trying to do this bit, that's clearly not you, and you'll come fake. And if they're trying to tell you what's happening in the industry, even though they don't know, they'll come across as fake. So what you need to do is work out the sweet spot in the middle, where you're not amending yourself too much. And then, you know, so it's great. If I work with a guy called Alistair Jarmer, he's a sales, some of you met him, nice fella, tall ex-copper. He's got a thing called sales styles. And you've got the kind of thinker, actor, doer, and friend. And he can tell literally by first word on the phone what kind of person you are, and he can match that straight away. And one of the complaints I hear about Ali is that it's a little bit smooth, a little bit. So you can kind of feel it. So use it to the point that still you would be the, if you're then fakerizing yourself over here.
Do you not think that would help you, having that knowledge, that would help you understand your ideal client customer base, which would then make it easier to talk to them about their problems while still being yourself?
Possibly. I might have a very short way of fixing that. Ask them. Yeah. I don't have to guess. I can just ask them. So I can imagine, I can stand in their shoes, or I can just go, hello, what's bothering you? And they'll tell me in their own words and that. So, and I think that there's a lot of this kind of stuff is overcomplicates things. Yeah,
given that this is about life,
yes.
This evening,
yeah.
It's an easy step to take to think that the way to be liked is to be nice.
Yeah.
Nice in general terms, not
here to tell you that's the wrong way of doing it.
But it does actually touch at the root problem with a lot of people who go to marketing, to social media, and that's the fear of the apprehension about putting yourself out there and not being liked.
It's going to happen.
Yeah.
It's going to happen. This is the thing, is that you could be lovely to everybody, and people might still hate you, because they make the decision based on what's going on in them, not what's going on in you. Yeah? Have you ever had that kind of day where everyone just bites at you, even though you're thinking, I'm doing the same as I do every day, I'm not doing anything different, and everyone's just having a go at me? It's not what's happening in you, it's what's happening in them. It just happens. So, myth 5, nice isn't real. So, moving on to the us bit.
25 to 5.
Oh, kidding, plenty of
German before ankle biters.
I can relax now, fantastico. One of my favourite ever humans, Oscar Wilde, urges us all to be yourself, everyone else is taken. This is possibly the core of being liked, okay? And exactly what Dave just said about understanding that no matter how hard you try, some people are just going to hate you. They just aren't. Not everybody's going to get you. You know, not everybody likes bananas. It's a taste thing. It's just one of those things, you know.
Did you fit in at school? Just a personal question.
Did I fit in at school?
Yeah, fuck no.
It got to a point where it was a deliberate decision. In psychological terms, what they call a polarity responder. If everyone zigs, I zag. If everyone says, oh, this is great, I hate it.
This is where I found myself, Preston College. I never had any friends.
Just polarity responder. You have a greater chance of success going the other way to the crowd. Just fact. So.
That's borne out by San Andreas.
With the rock.
With the earthquakes. Don't go when everybody else is going.
Exactly. You're dying. Exactly. Hollywood, I'm going to touch on some stuff in Hollywood later on, actually. But, yeah, I think it does have the rock in it.
It does.
I love him.
He's my favourite wrestler.
You know, he's Samoan.
Half Samoan, yeah.
You know, he's Samoan and he speaks the language and still does all the ceremonial dances and dances for his nan and all that. Oh, heartbreaking, he's beautiful.
If you smell,
yeah.
Yes.
He's quite good, actually. He cries in it.
I'm going to end this conversation with, if you ever get a chance to see Pain and Gain, see it.
Yeah. Is it that lucky?
It is hilarious. It's got Mark Wahlberg in it, which makes me think, I'd rather watch Paint Dry, but it is genuinely hilarious.
Well, I'm going to get the DVD after because it's for £3.
True story. Right, so, be yourself, everyone else is taken. So, the question is, who are you, professionally speaking?
Are we not doing professionalism,
though? You're professionally speaking. Not in a professional sense. Yeah. And who are you at work?
You can
what
tell
is business?
Public school, can't you?
Yes, I'm educated. Fuck all y'all. So, who are you? What's your personality, business wise? You say you're excused, but the rest of you fuckers should know this. It's your brand. Mm-hmm. Yeah. That's your personality, that's the experience of you. Brad. Yeah? That's your personality, that's who you bring to work. You know? And that's why the thing that the conversation that Dave Kirkwood had with you was a gift of value you have. It's massive. Because he gave you a way of responding to the world. Awesome. Dave's one of my branding heroes. He's amazing. He looks a bit like Paul Weller's dad.
Actually, when I first started, that's what I thought.
Yeah. Has he gone back to the whole mod father thing? Like he used to have a kind of feather cut mod thing, but then he changed and I think he's gone back now. So who are you professionally speaking? It's your brand. Okay? If you want, everyone's sure what their brand is. Mm-hmm. We've been having this conversation for maybe 3 years.
Sarah Pickard, sorry, for super perfect, super beautiful, everything.
Yeah. So if you're still unsure about what your brand is, anybody not sure, it's okay, I won't, you know, it's okay not to be sure. Yeah?
Apart from me, where's my
badges?
Okay. Okay. So I've got a little bit of a self-assessment for you. It's 4 questions. If you look a little bit more closely at your work, right, about what you do in everything, all of your business, I want you to assess what you do in terms of what you get to do, as in, oh, I get to do this, like, I love talking to people, I get to do this, this is what excites me about my job. What you want to do, what you have to do, because want to is like, yeah, great, I want to do that. I want to, you know, I like doing social media. It's not a get to do it. You know, I want to, it's all right, good. And then I have to do it, kind of arranging meetings, talking to university people, you know, kind of management. I don't particularly enjoy that. I have to, it's a necessary evil. And things that I should do, managing finances. Mm-hmm. Even though I've got a great piece of kit to do that, I've got a thing called Wave Apps, which does almost everything for you, still never do it. Should do. So if you think about your business, take a couple of minutes. Actually, just to make it quicker, I would definitely advise you, doing all of this, just having a little bit of an audit about your business, about what you get to do, what you want to do, what you have to do, and what you should do. But for now, concentrate on what you get to do. Right? What makes you giddy? What makes you happy? What, you know, everybody know about flow and what flow is. Mm. Yeah, that sense of when you start doing something, there goes the day. You know, you kind of go, oh, I'll do 5 minutes of this. I used to be a painter when I was a kid. That was what I was going to do. kind of oil painting stuff. And I could, when I picked my paint up, I would sometimes come to like 12 hours later. Just, I'd get so sucked into it. I didn't even exist at that point. It was just the picture I was making. So
that's the writer's life when it's going well.
Yeah, indeed. And yeah, I love to write, but when I have to write, I hate it. It's like childbirth, just painful.
I'm like that.
Yeah, absolutely.
Put my business.
The amount of tantrums, the amount of stamping about I did just to produce this, so I could come and talk to you guys this week, was massive. And I love talking to you guys, it's really good.
Tony Bazan would be proud of that.
Huh?
Tony Bazan would be proud of that.
It's busy. So, but even just producing that, sitting down and getting in the chair, that's... So that, for me, that would be a kind of have to, you know, to produce this. This right now, get to. So what for you guys is a get to do?
Do you want answers?
If you could write it down for you, this is for you guys to take home with you. What do you get to do, and why is it the get to do thing? Two down. Okay, really concentrate on the why. What is it about that?
About what we do.
Yeah. So I love this talking thing because I genuinely am saving the world. One person, one business at a time. I genuinely see it like that because that's what gets me out of bed in the morning. If I was just having a business. So what is it about you guys? What is it about, you know? Great design. Is it about getting people the spaces that they really want to engage with? Is it about, why does Andrew do a marketing? You want to increase love. You talk about love a lot. Yeah, knickers. But the knickers are the root to love. Yeah, really weird. You know, and it's this bit for you at the moment. Hey, come on, mate. It's this bit for your business that you're like, meh. Because at the moment, it's all kind of have to, should. we're good at what we do. It's tick, 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 tick. But what's going to be the next? Oh, fuck, we had to do this. Yeah? Because this get to, so where I make a massive statement and you'll go, huh? This is your brand strategy. Everybody grab that? Or everybody not grab that? Because if the why is your brand strategy, yeah? This is, if you're making badges to save the world and you enjoy it because you're creative and you bring people together, being creative and bringing people together is your fucking brand strategy, yeah? Mm-hmm. Make sense? If love and marketing and communicate, that's your brand strategy. I'm quite proud of this as me. But you know, if you haven't got the whole kind of three brand value statement thing that we were talking about last week, think about why you do what you do now, and that's your brand strategy for your own brand. Does anybody completely not get this? Good, we'll move on. Cool. So make sure you choose relationships that nourish you. And this comes as a massive shock to most people because they think they have to get ahead. But kissing ass is not a business development strategy. It really isn't. Because again, it's not being genuine. So choose relationships that you go, oh fuck, I get to meet them again. That's right. This is why I work with Sam. Because I mean, I met him, he rang me the other day, he said, Neil, I'm bored in the station. I live around the corner from the station. Neil, I'm bored in the station, come and talk to me. I'm sat here on a fucking toolbox, and I'm going mad. He had like an hour to wait for his train, and he was just having a stamp around the station. But meeting him is fun, even though it's business, even though we talked about some quite heavy brand stuff, I could work with Sam all day, every day, because it's fun. Like my friend Dave, who's a photographer who I was talking about before, grew with him all day, every day, because he's hilarious. He's dry, he's from Yorkshire. It should not be this. Never. If it is this, they're the wrong people to be working with, because they're more bothered about status than they are about working together. And if you're working with people who are bothered about status, might be different than your kind of thing, because, you know, lawyers and stuff. No. But if status is the thing, they're never ever going to be genuine with you, because they're always going to be, I'm here, you're here, fuck you. Mm-hmm. Yeah? Mm-hmm. Choose your relationships well. Yeah. And if it feels sticky and odd, obviously after a couple of times, sack it off. Yeah? So, choose relationships, that knows you. And be congruent. What we were talking about your brand strategy, about your three, about your personality, who you are. Who you are as a person. Does everybody know what congruence means? Yeah?
Anybody I'm not sure what you mean in this context.
Okay, well, exactly the same context. Congruent, you've got your three angles of a triangle, have to add up to 180. Have to. It's the rules. You know, that's geometry. It isn't just, if they don't add up to 180, then they don't join at one point, so they're not triangle. Yeah? So, same with humans. If your brand is, or if your personality is, oh, I'm happy, chirpy, happy-go-lucky, and I see you and you're like that, bastards. Sometimes we're all like this, but you're not being very congruent. Then I have to question myself, are they actually the happy-go-lucky?
I actually got accused of being negative because I was a bit annoyed that our British tennis players just basically fell out of Wimbledon. And I was like, how am I being negative? I'm allowed to be annoyed about it.
I think you're misunderstanding the point that tennis is irrelevant.
It was just the fact that I wanted to Heather Watson should have beaten Serena Williams, she didn't.
It's not even a good sport.
Oh, come on.
I think one example we had, I worked in a corporation where the lady who's in charge of personal development used to say to us, when you do this, you're in a safe environment. And every time after we had whatever it was she did, something would happen. And then, even as she was saying it, there wasn't a person in the organisation who trusted her, even though she said,
exactly.
This is a safe environment.
Yeah, and she's there like making notes and chuckling to herself.
And she permanently smiled.
Yeah, and it's niceness. Yeah, and it's arse, it's rubbish. So, congruence in this term means being who you say you are. You know, if your brand is serious, which is, it's okay for that. If your brand is dangerous, if your brand is miserable, perfect. Just be miserable. Yeah, whatever your three values are. Yeah, whatever your three values are, find ways of being more like that. It's like when I answer my business phone, I answer it in a particular way. When I'm always like this. I was dressed like this, just congruence, all the time. And I'm very rarely, I'm very rarely sweary, I'm very rarely appropriate. In fact, when people tell me I have to be, I usually go the opposite way. It's true. And I'm me all the time, and it should be the same for your business. Whatever you choose it to be, if it's about convenience for your business, how can you be the most convenient motherfucker in the world? You know, how can you just, here's another thing that you hadn't thought of that you want. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
So if it's going to be convenience, rock the convenience. So, in congruence, in being liked, congruence is everything. A lot of the time. Because if I'm a different person every time you meet me, can you trust me? If I'm radically different every time you meet me, you can't really believe, and I've said I'm a certain way.
You're a politician again.
No, politicians are always wankers. Apart from that Mary Black, who I'm absolutely in love with. She's like Tony Benn's bastard offspring. She's fantastic. Love her.
Why? Well, who is she?
She is an SNP politician. She's 20.
crying.
Oh, God, yeah. And she's the only credible politician apart from Glenda Jackson.
Yeah.
Why would she?
She stood up in Parliament.
Yeah. She gave her first speech the other day. It's all over my Facebook page. Have a look. She's magnificent. Not now. Yes, if you say you're a thing and then you're not like that repeatedly, then people will stop believing what you say. Boy, you cried wolf. Is the parable that fits this. So
Neil, I've got an example. I went to a networking thing and I had my hair back in a bun so nobody could see my pink. And then like the next time I saw people I had my hair in a ponytail, they were like, "Oh my god, you've got pink hair," and I think it just threw people. I mean, I was trying to be like approachable and like, you know, not scare them away the first time I met them.
Where is this?
But you're amazingly approachable. You're one of the nicest people I've ever met.
The whole point of having what you have is to be approachable. You're not stiff suit.
Absolutely, but yeah, I got a bit
And
yeah, it didn't work really. Because everyone's like, "You've got pink hair."
Exactly.
We didn't know that.
You'll get out of it eventually.
It shouldn't make a difference.
You can't hide it, you'll get out of it eventually. So
it's true.
Best be home for shoes and lamps, apparently. So, this, I think this guy's going to show up in a lot of my presentations from now on. I love the notion of Captain Obvious. He exists as a cartoon character.
Awesome.
Captain Obvious. One of the main fallacies humans kind of think is that they're masters of Zen subtlety. Obviously not really, but people they think that I shall say nothing and my face will be a mask of indiscretion. It's bollocks. You can read, you can see your emotions going across people's face like weather. Anybody ever seen Lie to Me?
Yes.
The Tim Roth thing, but micro expressions.
Yeah.
Absolutely in love with that.
That's a three series.
I know, it's based on fact, but I read my children all the time. It drives them nuts. Because it's always right. Always. So, Captain Obvious says, and this is going to be a feature, I think, of many things I do. Captain Obvious says, what you really think is completely obvious. So don't bother trying to hide it. You're not doing anybody any favors. Obviously, no crying. No stabbing, no, keep it within certain, Neil says I must act out all of my emotions. I feel like axe murder coming. No, but is obvious. And true inspiration is impossible to fake. It's one of those things, you can't fake. This is a kind of funny one. You can't fake it, but if you act like it's happening, it happens. Yeah? Anybody heard fake it like you make it? Mm. Fake it until you make it. It's kind of based on Victorian psychologist William James, who, check him out, it's brilliant. He coined this act as if principle, and they've done many double blind experiments checking this kind of stuff out. It's like, if you're miserable, put a pencil between your teeth. Mm-hmm. Yeah, absolutely fine. Because what that does is it makes you smile. Huh? And they've done tests, and it makes you actually happier. if you're depressed, the wood bit, not the lead bit, and it hasn't been lead since 1940 or something. But
he said
he's Victorian.
Yeah, he is. Yeah, she's got lovely lashes.
If you're depressed, stand up. Hit the hero pose and look at the ceiling.
That's your Superman pose.
I shit you not, it will cheer you up. Okay? Big deep breath. And it's from William James's act as if principle.
This is why I dance.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. Dance, you can't be miserable and dance. It's impossible.
I'll sing.
Pick one, take your dancing to absolutely.
Just go. Have a jiggle.
Pick.
Yeah. And this is the thing, is that genuine emotions are compelling. I'm coming to that in a bit actually. Living your brand, and this is the thing, is that as generally you're not part of giant multinational organisations, you are your brand, you are your business, pretty much. It's down to you guys to live your brand. Because if you guys don't, when's it going to happen? And this is another one of, like, the whole, get the message out. This is another one of my most hated things, right? Is the notion of poof and the magic happens. Yeah, and this is about doing it on purpose, because it's like, oh, I'm not gonna live my brand, poof, and then the magic happens, and my brand is gonna become magically apparent. Because I don't want to put the effort in, but somehow magically it's going to occur. It never is. If you're not being deliberate, if you're not making it happen, it will never happen. So living your brand is simply being yourself and infusing that into the daily work, life you work. Yeah? So you writers, if you're feeling... it's you guys are like the luckiest people in the world. Because if you're feeling like somebody else, you just write a different kind of book. Bullseye. You can't fall off. So, when you live your daily brand, when you kind of live your daily work, think about these three things. I keep mine being nice and prominent, especially at the beginning of it, when I was really kind of trying to hone out who I was and why it's important. I would have it on the wall. Quietness, propriety, niceness, and I'll make sure I'd live that every day. So,
doing a very good job.
It's amazing, isn't it? This works totally. So, think about your brand values, put them somewhere where you can see them, and then everything you do, go, how am I doing that? How am I doing that? Yeah, and you'll embody it eventually. So, this is super important. There's a bow tie and everything to show you how important it is. Super important.
Have you actually ever worn a bow tie?
Yeah, I've bow tie. I've been to a number of Oxford and Cambridge balls. Didn't jacket. Well,
is that where you studied?
No, I didn't. No, a couple of girlfriends did. My boy graduated there last year. I know I have a 25-year-old, so it's difficult to think about. The terrifying thing is, he's exactly the same as me. There are two of me.
Duplicating your brand.
Yeah, there are two. Honestly, I'm not even joking. It's terrifying. There are two of me. There was a point at which Bethany's Matt. He's called Matt, my son. My eldest. Matt. Me and Matt were sitting, just talking to each other, and we finished each other's sentences, and we are exactly the same person. And Dion, my wife, and Beth, his girlfriend, were sitting there just going, are you believing this? Because they couldn't believe. Yeah, anyway, carry on. So.
Has he got a quiff?
No, he does have shit hair, and he's not as good looking as me. So, we fucking get it. So. Not getting good, I'll ever. So, and here's the next principle is to be tasty. Everybody kind of get where I'm going with this. What taste do you leave in other people's mouths, metaphorically speaking? You know, it's like, for those people who are kind of still kind of newish to me, when you left last week, because 2 hours with me is quite a long time.
We've got four today.
Yeah. When you left last week, you will have had a taste in your mouth of the experience. Yeah? So, when people spend time with you, they will equally have a taste in their mouth, metaphorically speaking. There will be a kind of, you know, an aroma, a kind of a stench, a taste.
A pungence.
Yeah, exactly. I'm using the language deliberately, but what kind of taste do you leave in people's mouths? What do this? Because that's how you're likable, and this is the thing about mismatched people and nice people is that they don't leave a good taste in your mouth, right? There are some people that I absolutely fundamentally disagree with on almost everything. One of them, a guy called Dave Guest, lives in Lancaster. If he said the sky was blue, I'd have to go and check at the window. We literally disagree about everything, but he's one of my favourite people. Yeah, because he's one of the few people that doesn't back down from me ever, and he's quite happy to go at it with me, and I love that, because it never happens. And he's real. Love it. Absolutely love it. So he leaves a really kind of nice, zingy, kind of exciting, oh, I get to see Dave today taste. So what do you got? Have a think. And how do you know? Because vanilla is nobody's favourite.
You want a bet?
Get out. In general,
I had eaten mess yesterday.
But in ice cream terms, vanilla is rarely anybody's favourite. Yeah, because it, you know, I was doing some research. I mentioned Cluedo, but I was doing some research on ice cream, and you know, there's an Australian ice cream company that specialises in things like chili chocolate, and they make it with liquid nitrogen right in front of you. Yeah? Yeah, it's like it's a bit different to Mr. Whippy, isn't it? Yeah. You know what I mean? I'll get the tub out and do the scooping. No, I'm creating fucking science in front of you.
That's like, what's his face?
Heston. Yeah. Don't say a bad word about Heston, or I will have to kill you. He's one of my cookies. Love him. So, vanilla's nobody's favourite, right? So what I'm saying is be tasty. And that, ta-da, be tasty. Because you want to be somebody's favourite, even if it's only five people in the world. Be somebody's favourite. And you do that by being distinct. So, a little bit of an exam. What style are you? Okay, got a little bit of a personality test coming up. Circle, straight line, zigzag, or an angle. It's a very in-depth personality inventory there. So, first question. How do you make decisions? Do you make decisions fast, or are you considered? Okay, don't think too hard. Generally, do you make them fast, or are you considered? Okay? Mm-hmm. Yeah, I know there's an irony in that. Would you like an hour? Okay. So, how do you make this? If you want to come back in a little bit, how do you make decisions fast or considered? I hadn't thought of that. That was very funny. And what influences your decisions? Yeah? Objective information? Facts, figures, all that kind of stuff, or subjective information. Yeah, exactly, stuff like that, I don't care. I'm subjective all the way. How people feel, what relationship, the kind of subjective information about that thing, okay? So you will either be fast and considered, objective or subjective. So you'll be fast considered or fast subjective or, you'd be fast subjective, or considered objective, considered subjective. Yes? Which one of these are you?
I think I can say considered.
If you're going, but I haven't had time to make up my mind, you're fucking considered, right? Okay? Easy, right? And if you, when you, the influences on your decisions, are you saying, well, how can I make a decision about this? Because it could be anything, I haven't got enough facts to go on. You're an objective. That's objective. Yes. Okay. And if you're just going, oh, it feels like subjective to me. Yeah, in the moment kind of thing. Okay. So everybody got their little values.
Yeah.
Okay. So if your first one is that if you make decisions in a fast way, if you're objective, you're a straight line. Okay. Your priority, get it done. Yeah. Your logical, rational, pragmatic focus, concrete. You value performance. You value, by performance it means you value, like, performing to a high level. Direct and concise communication, and when people misperceive you, arrogance, bossy, and then you think you're always right. If you said subjective, then you're zigzag. Okay? Your priority, get creative. And that you're imaginative, vision, your future focus in it. This is me, by the way, in case anybody hasn't.
It's so funny, because just looking at the shapes, I just knew I was a zigzag.
Yeah. It's almost like it's been
called. I did that as well. I looked at the zigzag one, that's me.
Yeah, exactly. Values are experimenty, risk-taking, high energy, and we all can be misperceived, the fuckers, as too idealistic, impractical, and too talkative of all things. So, if you're considered, this is you, Pierre. One of these, I'd say, probably this, yeah. So, objective, angle.
Really?
Get
it's
it right.
Angles, lady.
No?
Which is that type of boring?
That's misperceived.
No, but...
How dare you misperceive me in a way I don't enjoy it? How dare you?
When I just say body language,
language. Can I just say, did you notice how stiff she uses
that? Dare anybody call me bitches, motherfuckers? Anyway,
that whole posh you went, how dare you?
However, on the good side, your organ. Oh, this will probably be you as well.
It is me, but punctuality. I was.
It's not 100%. It's not 100% hit.
Were you, were you on time to your wedding?
That's close enough. Seriously.
How? Nearly.
Same week.
Yeah, same week.
Cracking
yeah.
on. We're organised, detail oriented, systematic.
Sorry, I'm just taking a picture of that.
Can
I
you don't want to get in the way of anything. And they're considered subjective types of circles. They get consensus, they're very people orientated, they build relationships, they're social, tolerant, empathic, loyal, they believe in cohesion, consensus, and relationships, and misperceived as too nice. There is nobody in this room who is perceived as too nice. Promise you, you little bastards. So, I was joking. Anybody heard of Albert Moravian? Right, okay, you will have, but. Style is really important, and this is why I'm going to talk about style now. Albert Moravian is a psychologist from University of California. And what he says is that only 7% of what the words that we say have any impact. Right? It's only 7% useful. 38% is about the voice and the tone, and 55% is about the body language. Now, one way of thinking about this is words, music, dance. Yeah? So, when you, and this is why I'm talking about being on purpose and being deliberate and being that kind of thing, is that if, how much attention do you pay to these things? Yeah? As writers, you're going to be thinking, okay, sentence structure, if I'm trying to inject pace, it'll be short words, shorter sentences, that kind of, maybe lots of plosives and stuff. Do you put the same amount of care into the business side of things about what impression am I generating when I answer the phone, when I arrive places, when I, if my brand is this, whatever this may be, and my personal style is whatever, then how can I use these techniques to deliver my brand? Yeah? Which is why your goat story is really interesting. Because if you're doing something super wacky, then in order to be taken seriously as super wacky, you've got a really great kind of origin story, which is super wacky. Now, I tell you, we're fucking hardcore nutcases, we are. I tell you, blah, 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 and this is why. Yeah? Yeah. I had the idea for this when I was living with a goat. Yeah, you know what I mean?
And it's not like,
really
that crazy.
No way. Anyone else lived in a goat? Anyone else lived with a goat?
You live with a goat. Does it count? In India, is that common?
We've come from pretty closely where you live with a goat. Pretty close, exactly. This wasn't in another building. This was living with the goat.
I did get very close when I was little, but I didn't.
Very close.
But wait, I was seven years old. Come on.
Right. So. Well, the reason why I mentioned this is be tasty.
Next to a goat.
Be distinct. Awesome. Be zesty. Leave a great flavour in somebody's mouth, right? Mm-hmm. Because it matters. Mm. It really does. Nobody nobody goes, oh, let's get some of that vanilla ice cream. And I know of some great vanilla ice cream. Where I come from in the Northeast, there's a shop that only sells vanilla ice cream, right? Only. And I've seen queues outside of the front door of that in February. It's very, very good. It's made from the cream of a local herd. It's super, kind of sourced, and it's amazing stuff. But still, if somebody said mint choc chip, the queue would probably vanish because mint choc chip's better. So
they just have trays and trays and trays.
Yeah, no, it all comes out of one big tub. They just make it and then tip. But literally, queues in fucking February. So, how do you tell your story? And this is kind of, as well as the no, this is how do you do that? How do you do it? This is all about the how. So, doing business on purpose, so that whichever words you use, whichever tone you use, whichever dance you use, It's on purpose. Energy matters, as you're probably aware. Anybody know any kind of mood hoovers?
People who kill your mood.
Yeah. Yes. You know mood hoovers where you kind of. Yeah. But you know what I mean?
Energy
vampires, they come around your house and you just they leave and you're fucking exhausted. And it's like, all they do is they moan about the shit.
My next door neighbour, when she comes in, I go into the room.
Yeah. My wife has a friend called Ruth, and I can't bear to be in the same room as her. Because she literally, I can feel myself like that, like deflated.
I call them deaf eaters.
When,
I call them deaf eaters.
Exactly.
It just sucks.
Exactly.
The life out of the room.
I did once have a go at it. I said, can you not actually just be morbid? Can you actually be happy?
It's not their fault. This is the thing. It really isn't their fault. They don't do it. Not once, many years. That's just their A game. That is their A game. That's the best they get. Right? That is the best they get. That's the A game. Energy matters. Right? And I'm going to kind of give you a little bit more detail as you go. Computers, programmers have a really great phrase, which is garbage in, garbage out, right? If you bring a shitty set of energy into a room, what are you going to take away with you? They're going to give you it right back, because people are mirrors.
I've actually stayed home from a networking event because of that, because I was in a shit mood. I went, you know what? No point in going, because I'm going to get nothing out of this.
So, garbage in, garbage out. Be really good. And this is why brands come in, right? Because you can just go, okay, this is how I'm going to be, and then you step into it. Elvis Presley.
Your style icon?
No, actually no. Elvis Presley used to have a certain amount of steps before he went on stage.
There was a thousand or something.
And he'd leave his changing rooms as a man, and he would kind of start 1,000 steps, and he'd have a little pattern, and have a little pattern, and have a little pattern. By the time he got to the stage, he was fucking, Elvis Presley. Totally different dude. Yeah, totally different. Michael Phelps. Swimmer. This is why I'm not in the Olympics, right?
You get gold.
Michael Phelps. I was reading about his training schedule, and his training schedule is so rock solid. He does it the same every single day. In the last Olympics he competed in, he dived into the pool, and his goggles filled with water. So he swam the whole race blind. One gold, because he just rocked his training, and he just the pattern, and this is how brand works. You rock the pattern. So garbage in, garbage out. Good energy, as we all know, is contagious. We all like being next to that crazy fucker who buys all the beers, and it's like, ooh, let's go mental, because it's fun for a bit. the reason why I put this up is that you may not believe this, my background's in performance. And I've performed on stage a lot. Studied the method of Strasbourg and Stanislavski, very slightly different. But the central tenet is, if you want the audience to feel something, you have to feel it first, and then you bring the audience to you. Yeah? It's the same. Someone said something. It's the same with brand. Yeah, you can't expect people to respond to your brand in a different way than you do. Yeah, so if you want people to get excited about your brand, be excited. If you want people to be impressed by your brand, be impressed. Go there first. This is the core of method acting. So, let's have a break. How's that? Is that making any sense whatsoever? Good. Let's have a little break. Five minutes or so. Then I'll break.
Your very first funnel.
Yeah.
Now, this last week. So yeah. I know going for this. But this is a how to like make people like you, and it's a one to many. And most of what you talked about so far was one-to-one.
It's not at all.
I am.
What I'm saying is...
Yeah. Thank you. I understand the principle, what I'm missing is the how.
You're after the buttons and the magic bullets, aren't you?
Yeah.
Yeah, they ain't coming. because I don't do that. I do principles. Yeah? That I'm not going to go, what you need to do is a 40-word Facebook post with a picture on the left featuring blah, 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 blah. Because it doesn't matter.
Whatever she wants to see.
It doesn't matter. If you want you, if you are congruent to your brand, and if your brand is interesting, people will give a shit. Right? If you ask them questions, and if you listen to the answer of those questions, they will create a relationship with you, regardless of the format, regardless of the platform. Yeah? So there's how you rig your communications, what platform it goes on, doesn't matter, as long as you're doing these things.
Yeah, I get bits of it.
You're looking too close. They're just the principles. It's not about...
What's the story about the goat?
The key things for you in your business would be find out how people research venues.
And kind of a job.
I would imagine for you it's an SEM thing.
And
we've
had a lot
the biggest problem I've got with what we've got in our business is Google hates us.
Yes. So you're going to have to find a way around that.
Why does social media
Why does Google hate us?
Because it kind of competes with what Google's trying to do, and Google preference their own things over
your black-hatted SEO nonsense that you got on your website.
Yeah.
Yes, that's why you've tried to bend the rules. Google have caught you.
Google's a machine, it's not a human. We've tried to put something together that works for a human.
Have you, Mike, is it Mike Cutts? Guy from Google. Who explains SEO?
Yeah.
If you look at Mike Cutts' stuff online, he will explain exactly, because you can't, you don't SEO a website, you SEO a single page.
Yeah.
And
I've got 25,000 pages.
Yes.
I can't SEO every single one of them.
You have to, because that's how Google indexes them.
So you've got to pay somebody in China or in India to do it?
But they just go and do crap.
Okay, the question is, how do your visitors look for property or venues?
Well, our website's kind of mirrored on Rightmove.
Doesn't matter.
No, well, everyone knows of Rightmove.
Yeah.
How do you look for property on Rightmove?
Doesn't matter how you think your website needs to look. What I'm saying is that your website needs to be the end of search for something.
Yes.
It needs to be the end of the search. It needs to be the end of, you need to close the inquiry, okay? How does that inquiry happen? When I'm looking for a venue, what do I do?
Well, actually, we're not trying to be the end of the search. We're trying to be the middle of the search.
Okay.
We are trying to be the tool for the search.
Okay, so how did... I refer you to my earlier question. How do people search for venues?
We believe that they say, I want a venue somewhere.
Yeah, what they'll do...
They know roughly where they want to be. They want to be in the Lake District. They want to be
in the bar. They want to be... They'll go Church Hall... June, Preston.
Yep.
You need Google to be your friend.
Yeah.
There's no escaping it.
The others do. The others are fine.
Yeah.
But Google really doesn't like it.
So 4% of the market think you're right.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay. So you're going to have to find a way of making Google like it.
Yeah. Well, one of the reasons we're here is, can we use social media to try and bypass it?
You can't bypass it.
To get that first bit.
You
know your thing, you said social media gets them down the first two steps of a problem.
Can do, yeah.
Well, that's kind of like, we'd like that. That'd
okay.
Good.
Okay.
But the website, I don't know, people tell me they like it.
Doesn't matter.
I think it works.
Doesn't matter.
But
doesn't matter what they like.
But
what matters is how many people find venues by the site.
Yeah. Google is very strange. Sometimes it will do exactly what we expected it, but other times it just doesn't want
to. In that case, I would make a complaint to Google.
You can't talk to Google. I've not found a way to actually have a conversation with Google. Well, if you know that, you're worth a fortune.
Well, the thing is,
if you can have a serious conversation...
Google send their people out all the time. Right? Google send their people out to events, conferences and that kind of thing. That's the place to talk to Google, because they do have people, they do Google places, and they talk about
there things. Are people who work for Google, I'm sure.
Yeah, exactly, there are. And if you go and talk to them, they're absolutely happy to talk about how they do what they do, because they've made a really big secret, a big thing around it not being a secret. Talk to them.
There's this thing called Webmaster Talk, which is kind of an interface for the average human being into Google.
It isn't.
And it tells you it likes our site, doesn't dislike our site.
And it can't but
it actually doesn't do what it should do.
Cool. I've done it a number of times.
It could just be that you're in a remarkably competitive industry.
Yeah. It is very competitive.
Your site just isn't as well
optimised
as your competitors.
Yeah, we know what some of the problems are. Some of the problems is how we built the data. But there is no other way unless you've got £500,000 to throw at it.
Okay. So social-wise, just to kind of refer back to that question, the BU... would be, why do you do what you do?
You want to make some money.
Yeah, well, that.
Okay.
Fail.
Next question.
Frankly, fail. Okay. What you want to do is help people find the venue of their dreams.
Yeah.
Okay. So how do they perceive that?
Well, what we've done is we've tried to create the most comprehensive list of venues that exist.
Does list say care to you? Does
it? Pages isn't around
every... Exactly. Lists. Okay. If you're expecting people to fall in love with a list, if you're expecting people to engage with a list, other than by Google or some other search machine.
Well, all Google is a list. People love Google.
No. People love what Google does.
Yeah.
Okay. People love the results of Google, not the machine of Google. Yeah.
If you search for a venue in Preston on Google,
you'll
find the same 10 big venues that stand out on Google.
Yeah.
You won't find the village hall around the corner that may suit your need. You won't find the church hall down in the middle of town that may be absolutely ideal for you. And they'd love you to run their conference.
Great. Fantastic.
There.
In that case, how... Exactly. No. We agree on everything. We do, marketing-wise. Yeah. What you need to do is have some kind of branding thing going on about venues that don't usually show up. Because, A, you've got something to market to the venues, and then you go, okay, if you're not the Masonic Lodge, if you're not the giant Jans whatever in Blackburn, if you're small, intimate venues, come to us. You have to bespoke it. It can't just be the biggest list. It can't just be, well, we're trying to make money. You have to create a value proposition.
The feedback we get is that we work well for the venues and we work well for the people who find our site and use it to hunt for the venues.
Yeah.
Where we fall down dramatically
is
that if you just type in venues for hire in Preston,
it
may or may not appear on the
list. Okay, then in that case, what you need to do is have a massive social campaign around those case studies, around people talking about what a fantastic time they've had, what an amazing thing it is, with a massive foot ton of keywords in it, going, venue Preston, such and such a hall, venue Preston, such, so that when people do search for it, maybe not your site, but that individual page comes up, and they find your...
So is it not the adjectives that you're using, such as alternatives and the bespoke and the relevance. How often do you add new content to your website?
When you say
content,
listing them. Can we crack on? Can we talk about this afterwards?
Sorry. We'll chat.
But that's the thing, is the fact that if what you need to do is produce content that is searchable. Yeah? Because that's what will help you do what you want to do. Okay? The way you make content searchable is by doing this.
Okay?
So, we're going to look at them now and the relationship with others. Starting off with the magic of questions. I'd like you, for a minute, to imagine that I was your husband. Okay? I can get no expense spared with this pay stuff. So obviously, we're very much in love. And all I do in our relationship is
I see a pink in that bun, so.
Are you the dominant or submissive type?
Pardon?
Are you the dominant or submissive one?
I am the amazing type. That's as far as it goes. How would the relationship work if I just talked at you?
Much as it is.
If I was just talking at you, in every single sense, how long would that relationship last? Now consider your marketing talk. how many questions do you ask in your marketing? How much research do you do in your marketing? How much do you engage with people in inquisitive terms rather than declarative terms? Yeah? Because, as we said before, marketing is a business is a relationship and marketing is a conversation. If you're only having one conversation, one side of a conversation, then is the other person going to stay around very long in that conversation? No. Guess. So, curiosity may well have killed the cat, but curiosity has never murdered a conversation. Never. Not once. Because that's what conversations do. I mean, don't interrogate people. If you interrogate people, then, that's equally as little fun. But the power of questions is enormous. Because questions plus answers equals customer challenges. Hi, how are things with you today? Well, okay, so what are your key challenges at the moment? Well, I wish I had a little bit more income. Okay, fantastic. Why would you like a little bit more income? Well, maybe because then I could look to invest or bring another piece of staff member of staff even, etc., etc., etc. I can find, and I know that you're in the market for something that will help you grow your income so you can bring on staff. So when my marketing happens, if you're looking to grow your business and expand it, maybe bring on some staff. This product will help you. Increase your income. And that happened by asking questions. Yeah? So, customer challenges plus innovation equals new products. And that's where you earn your money. And the thing is, if you market back at people in this, if you market back at people, in the same terms as they answer the question, it's like you're reading their mind. Does that make sense?
Yeah.
Yeah. I wouldn't want to just talk at you or anything. So.
You just sexify the minds of your clients, don't you?
Pardon?
You just sexify the
sexify. Clients. These days, I'm too old to sexify their bodies. So, and this is the key. This is the key questions. Is the fact that we were talking before. About getting in the minds of your clients. This is how, rather than guessing, rather than using some newfangled technique, rather than NLP or whatever is happening this year or decade, ask, listen to the answers. Does everybody know how to ask a question? This is not a trick question, by the way. Just, when you think about your businesses, do you know how to ask? Anne's really good at this, by the way. Anne's fantastic at surveying. She's taught me stuff. She's lovely. But when I ask questions to my customers or potential customers, I make it an open question. I ask their opinion, or I give them options and ask them to choose one, or I ask for their ideal solution. Yeah? Would you like a plug and go thing, or would you like a cable thing, or would you like this thing, or would you like that thing? Or if we could prevent your phone from running out of battery, what would be the ideal solution for you? For instance, you know what I mean? Yeah. Then they go, oh well, actually, it would be some kind of flying mammoth that would come in and deliver electricity via its trunk. Fantastic. Yeah. Be fantastic. And then the follow-up question, how come? How come that would be good? How come this would be good? Oh, well, it's less force. Well, how come this would be good? Well, you see, I could carry it in my pocket. How could it be? And then you start getting a little bit more granular on the detail. Yeah? It's like what we were talking about last week, about getting to know your clients a little bit better. And kind of saying, oh, you left us. How come? And then I go, well, was it a price thing? Was it a service thing? Was it a technology thing? Was it this? Oh, it was a price thing. Oh, how come? Was it massively cheaper? Was it just the service thing? And then you start having a conversation. Yeah? SurveyMonkey's amazing for this, but if you really want to get to know people, pick up the phone.
We said that sadly at the same time. That was freaky.
Pick up the phone, because it's real. You know, and you develop a relationship, and then when you've spoken to them on the phone, get to know them a little bit better, carry on the relationship, even if they're not buying from you, they might in the future, because chances are that the other person who's done the sales from the other company has done that whole kind of sell and run thing, and you're like, don't worry about buying from us, we'll just talk. Have you seen our new such and such? Just, can I get your opinion on it? What do you think? And then they're into talking about the new inventory, then they're going, do you just want to try it for a bit? That's a lot better, isn't it? Well, you see, you're paying more for what you've got. Yeah? See how this might work?
I made a decision about a week ago.
Yeah.
If I could not email someone and phone them, because I'm just getting sick of emails. And this last week, just by phoning people, things have just started moving so much quicker.
Yeah.
Because, I don't know, you just do build a relationship quicker on the phone.
Exactly.
And people answer things quicker and make decisions quicker. And it's just massively accelerated things.
Anne and I bonded on the phone almost immediately. Yeah. I called you, and we just got on immediately.
Yeah, and that's, I'm going to just carry on with that now.
Yeah.
But isn't it interesting, our world's now full of emails.
Yeah.
That we thought would speed business up.
Yeah, it's just doesn't. And people ignore emails, but they won't ignore a phone call.
Gary Vaynerchuk always says marketers ruin everything. So I think
they've
ruined email to the point now where that's now the junk mail, spam.
Yeah.
Which is why I think Anne was saying the other day that the letters and actual mail works really well now.
Mm-hmm. Well, if you handwrite something or send a card, and it's not a bill, people open it because it's like, wow, isn't that nice? Mm-hmm. I've got some, after kind of talking to Anne and a little while back, I've got some really lovely branded thank you cards. And I just went after I worked with somebody and just sent them, and they're orange and they're really mean and quite rude on the front, surprisingly, and it's quite clearly for me, and it's just like, they open it and they respond, and I've never not had a return phone call, but answer the card, man, even for men. Mm-hmm. So, ask questions, because it really makes a difference, and ration Google, because it can tell you about your customers, yeah? If you want to know more about what's happening in your sector, call the people you know in your sector, rather than just go, oh, what are creative businesses doing in Manchester area, blah, 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 because that information has been filtered and run through and amended and dealt with, and so much so that it's no longer useful. And if you do the research yourself, you miss out on the relationship. If you don't do the research yourself, you miss out on the relationship. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. I'd have to scoot to a level on that.
Okay.
Because I use Google a lot for when I'm doing specific one-on-one letters.
Okay.
To go research the company, and I dig into all the articles that are out there.
Yeah.
Find their problems, what's happened, and then the letter becomes very personal based on what I find.
One company may be different, but what I'm thinking of is researching the sector.
Yeah.
I use LinkedIn.
Yeah, I use Twitter, frankly.
I find people on LinkedIn in the company and I phone them up.
Yeah.
I would argue that you're not actually using Google apart from as an address book to try and find them. You're using their website.
I use Google to find a number.
You're using other information, not what Google's actually giving you.
Yeah.
Google's not a boring test.
Yeah. Well, it depends
on what you're doing. Unfortunately, it's massive, it's kind of all invasive and it's taken over the world.
So, but the thing is, if you're researching people, if you're ringing up and going, hiya, can you tell me a little bit about your business?
Mm-hmm.
Hiya, I've not seen you. We met at that networking event. I'm not trying to sell anything. Can we just talk about blah, blah, blah? They feel like, okay, I've got a couple of minutes, or can I take you out for coffee, or can I such? Mm-hmm. They feel like connected. They feel like their opinions matter. They feel more connected to you. And you start building up. It's like, if I wanted to know, about anything that you guys do. I ring you guys.
There's an add-on to that as well, isn't there? Which is, when you're talking to someone, never miss the opportunity to say, is there someone else that I could talk to, and could I use your name when I contact them? Because an introduction is that little bit better than just getting in touch and saying, can I ask you some questions?
Exactly. And it's about that relationship thing that happens in the middle. Yes, that, what we're saying before, it's about building something in the middle between you. So, because all marketing is conversation, and the better you get at facilitating that conversation, which is why if you guys want to start doing content, do stuff that's conversive, conversational. So that it's like, oh, we stayed here, it was fantastic. And then you're not looking at just hardcore SEO stuff, you're talking about value, people, that kind of thing. Yeah? So, power of listening. It's all very well asking people questions, and this is kind of stuff you touched on Tuesday, about if you're going to ask people questions, make sure that A, it's something you want to know the answer to. My six-year-old's a nightmare for this, because she just asks questions she already knows the answers to, and she's just absorbing your attention. Hi, why is it sunny? Because the sun's in the sky. But why is it? She's asking us attention. And ask questions that you really want to know the answer to, and then listen, and then act on what you find. Because the thing is about when you listen and you stop talking, you step back and you create space. Okay? And what happens generally is that people move into that space. Right? They take a step towards you when you listen. You know what I mean? It's like if you're in a relationship, someone asks you a question and then they let you just talk rather than let you make a point and then they just let you just talk, so tell me more about that, tell me more, tell me more, tell me more. And then they move into that space and they tell you what they want. Yeah, so you're giving them the space just to be themselves. And the whole thing about listening is that they'll come towards you and they feel it's refreshing. Right? We are making decisions all day, every day, constantly. Being bombed with information, we're having to make decisions whether to delete, disregard, or distort it. Whereas if you're just going, tell me what you think, gives you a chance to relax, doesn't it? What do I think? And then you're working at your own pace, and that's really comfortable. Is this making a lot of sense? Okay, so this is how it works. Ask, listen, act. Yeah? So when you ask questions, little light bulb going on there.
I'm thinking, just as an example, this week, after speaking to you last week, we sent surveys out because we're a service-led company, but I wanted to know about what people really thought about us, not just about our service.
Oh, right.
Yeah. So I got to the ladies in the office, basically just on every school in the area.
Oh, good.
And they got, one of them said, I'll just send emails out. I was like, no!
Good work.
So they phoned all good, but that turned into, you do this really well, and I hate this company, which was in fact the local council, for doing this.
Yeah.
And we were like, right, so then we did a piece, it was a better system they did, so we did a piece on how we could do that better, and within 4 days, we'd taken, out of the 74 schools in William, we'd taken 58 of them from the council.
Congratulations, where's my cup?
Drinks are on you!
Well, good work.
Yeah, it was just to sort of back up that.
You see how it works, though?
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. If you listen and make direct contact with, like, your phone calls, it is amazing, isn't it? Yeah. It is just, this is the power of real communication. Mm-hmm. Because people don't anymore. People do the least work for them. Yeah. Rather than the thing that'll create the relationship in the middle. Yeah, this is why email. So the cycle: ask, listen, acts. Ask, listen, act. Acts. I can't even say it, man. You can read. So, but it's cyclical. So you constantly going back and back and back, and they'll tell you what they want. This is obviously slightly different size than my slide. This is a new Japanese artist I found. It's fantastic. He just takes pictures. He took pictures of blurry ravens for 10 years. That's all he did. And then he took pictures of his. Was that after his second wife left him? His name escapes me, he's got a great show on at the moment in London. But he
obsessively picked up his wife.
Yes.
Every day.
Yeah. Oh yeah. And she got sick and left, obviously.
Well, he just basically sat there all day.
Annoying
her. It was really formulaic, because he would stand at an upstairs window and he would take pictures outside of from this upstairs window, and she had to be
prime stalker.
Japanese chap. Anyway, she left him hours after. She left him, and then he took the Ravens pictures.
Because he refused to take pictures of anything apart from his wife until she left.
Yeah. And even
why did he take pictures?
He said it was just a really passive aggressive way of controlling my wife. So, bless him.
Is that why he did that?
Yeah, he admitted it. No case. He takes very nice pictures of ravens, though.
Yeah,
they're
lovely.
So,
it was lovely.
It is lovely.
Yeah, you can take some in context now.
But he's got some really nice ones, which are kind of they're done with a kind of light bounced in, and there's some with the little eyes are all kind of glinty. It works lovely. So, Birds of a Feather. The short story is people like them. Yeah. What I'd be interested in thinking about is when you did your customer persona last week for the people that you most want to work with, compare that to you. Yeah? Compare that to you. And how does that match up? Because I would argue, or probably posit rather than argue, that your persona that you want to work with is very similar to you as a person. Yeah? Okay, that's because we all like to be around people like us, generally.
Seth.
This is Seth. This is all hail to Seth.
Who's that? That's twice now.
Get out. This is Seth Godin. He.
Another surname.
Yeah. This is the Seth. Seth Godin. Possibly he invented most of marketing these days. He's a very, very clever man. And he's got a really great Udemy course on Udemy about freelancing. Did you do that?
Yeah, I'm in the middle of it.
It's lovely, isn't it? It's just mind-blowing and genius. Brilliant. So, he kind of came up with the concept of tribes and about social proof and the question that people ask themselves when they encounter your marketing isn't will it work, but will it work for me? Yeah? And this is why social proof exists, and people don't use scientists in adverts anymore, because what they want is somebody like themselves in the advert, who can go, I'm just like you,
yeah.
Works for me.
It's more you can identify more with it, that's
exactly.
That's how we're doing that with marketing. That's how we're doing that with marketing.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah, so, and this is the kind of thing, birds of a feather tend to fly together, right? Because what you're trying to do is match your values with the people who give a damn about the same as you do. And there's a kind of number of ways you can do this. One is social proof. I liked it. You will too. There's also you too, me too, which is the world is like a kind of mirror for us. And I just wanted to kind of touch on the Global Geordie Network.
Yeah, man.
I'm not sure whether this happens to people from other places, but tiny short story. In 2001, I was kind of living with this woman in York, and we were spending Christmas with her family, rural York, place called Stamford Bridge, population about 8 people. And we went to this local bar, and the guy behind the bar turned out to be from where I was from in Newcastle, and he used to run this kind of tiny pub called this tiny pub called the Cooperage, which is, have you been to the Cooperage? Yeah, exactly, it's a shithole. It's like built in 1580 something, tiny little thing. And he used to run the Cooperage. And this is the thing about the Global Geordie Network. If you have a Geordie accent and you go anywhere, you talk to another Geordie, it's like their long lost family. I don't know whether it happens with anywhere else, but honestly, it's terrifying. You go, because I walked in and talked to, I used to be in the Cooperage. And I used to run the crew, because it starts like, oh, where's your accent from? And you know, you're from blah, 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 and it starts. And then he goes, oh, he's, well, I used to run the crew, oh, he's drinking there. There, Broken Doll Junior, blah, 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 blah. And then he starts just giving me free beer. So I just give him free beer, and all night, we're cracking on. Yeah, he's still working and all that, we're having a good crack. And I'm with my girlfriend's brother, who has drank there for 15 years, never got a free pint of beer out of this guy. Purely because...
You're a Geordie.
Purely because... It's on Global Geordie Network. Purely because I know the pub he used to work at. Free beer all night, and when I left, he gave me a bottle of wine.
Quit then.
Exactly. Nice one. But this is because the Geordie race is so strong. I'm not joking, though, because you can always tell a Geordie, we're all very
friends
similar.
With Anton Deck, aren't you?
I used to drink in the same pub as Anton Partley, yeah.
There you go.
So, it's a very small place.
I bet he knows Alan Shearer as well.
Yeah, I used to play football against him. So, elbow cheating bastard. So, that my way of saying he was significantly better than me. So, but this is what I'm saying about birds of a feather going together. It's like, because we share value, because we're from the same place, you do. Because we're from the same tribe, literally,
gold
tribe, we back each other, even if we don't know each other. Yeah? And this is how do you identify your tribe? And this is a kind of really clear question for those people who, specifically the writers, who are your readers? What are your tribe? You know? Who are your, are they eco warriors? Are they business people with a conscience? Are there a number? So who are your people? Yeah, same with you guys. Who are your people? If you're fighting the cause of people who don't want to pay stupid money for massively too big venues, or they want kind of control in a small place, or that kind of thing, how can you be their champion? Yeah, and that's what your content does. Yeah, that's the content you share. That's the content you create. Because you've now got a brand story. We're going to show you the... Once you've had a look through Google, we'll show you the good venues they don't see. Yeah? We've got the specialist stuff. We've got the cool stuff. We've got the...
That's secret hotels, isn't it?
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. Secret hotels is a really good example. Have you seen the adverts? Mm-hmm. Incredibly beautiful lady going, shh, it's a secret. Come here. Your brand needs to be something away from the mainstream, where we do clever stuff most people don't see, yeah. But we'll help you find the venue that suits you, and then you've got testimonial, 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 case study, case study, case study, case study, and then fuck yeah, that's what they do, yeah. So that's how your content works, and that's about tribalism, yeah. So when you, how can you create a tribe out of these schools in Wigan? Yeah, because they all live, they all value the same stuff roughly. How can you turn them into a kind of a group social event?
Yeah, we've got one in a couple of weeks. Yeah.
Come down. We'll buy a couple of beers. We'll do the blah blah blah, and we'll have a chat. And they put a face to your name. You become the lovely, happy, smiling face in the middle.
It's our 20th anniversary this year. So we're doing a big event for it, a big social thing. And we thought people wouldn't come because they'd think, you know, bribery, free beer, all that sort of stuff.
People like that. What? Exactly. Hang on, you mentioned my two favourite words, bribery and free beer. Fantastic. You know, I'm about to do some speaking later on in the year for Penland Events about how events can make you money, how you can grow your business by using events, and they're very, very useful if you get it right. No? So, how can you create a tribe out of your followers? You know, with your kind of coaching clients, are they of a kidney? Do they have an ilk? And then how can you bring them together? I'm a massive fan of parties for business purposes. Because you come in and you just, everybody kind of checks their ego at the door. Hi, would you like to do some, I'm having a Jamaica Day party, actually. You're all invited. Four Riverside, Preston, all invited, come down. We're moving the weekend after, so the house doesn't matter.
When's this? When's this?
You're invited, you've already said you're coming.
Oh, yeah, of course, but when is it? I've forgotten the date.
1st of August. daytime, bring the kids. It's a whole family party, Jamaica Day party. Bring some food, and if you want to drink something, come along. I'm serious, open invite.
And I said, I'm coming, it's a couple of days.
Come along, it'll be great. I'm cooking some, what we're having, some curry goat, a few dumplings, etc, etc.
You're going to cook their favourite animal.
Yeah, it's my favourite meat. It's my favourite meat.
Cannibal. Most Jamaican curry goat is actually mutton. So,
why do you think she shared the?
Yeah, exactly. Well, get fat on my kitty.
Make a lovely
stew. Eat me as well. So,
well, she came back the goat run
out. Exactly. So, how can you create a tribe like the Global Georgian Network of your people, or how can you create a common cause? Yeah.
Give him a gay flag.
I love this picture. Love it. It's annoyed almost everybody in America. It's a copy of the Iwo Jima thing. And it's a bunch of gay dudes raising a Castro flag skull. But,
and you've got a black guy in there as well. That was really, really piss him off.
Well, the thing is, I'm a, you know, with my background in theatre, I'm a big exponent of gay rights and all that kind of stuff. And this is a lot of what I believe in is about equality and all that kind of stuff. This is something I believe in quite a lot. If you had a cause-based business, like your wood, eco-tastic, save the goats kind of badge work, then...
Save the goats for their stew.
Yeah. Well, you've got to have a reason. If you have a cause, don't be ashamed of it. Yeah? Go on. If you have a cause, if your cause is getting the people the best venue for their money, that's your cause. You can make a crusade of it. You can turn that into graphics. You can do all kinds of stuff with it. And it's better than just, we're a listing site. We're about making money. You've got something that people can give a shit about then. Yeah?
You've got to have that human aspect.
If it's about never be without charging your phone again, we'd all love that.
Right, unless you got a phone like this bugger.
Yeah, buy a Nokia 6310, it lasts for a fortnight. Yeah. It makes phone calls and does texting.
Russell still uses
it. What's your cause, you know? Is it about learning stuff? Is it about, you know, people experiences?
I've got a break phone now.
You know, David, you know, what's your cause?
My cause is about turning groups of people into teams.
Ta-da! Exactly. Perfect. Exactly. Brilliant. So, how can you create birds of a feather? How can you show people that you are like them and vice versa? Okay, so, again, I'm gonna probably rock up with Martin Luther King every week. So, Martin Luther King.
Malcolm X next week, he was just as charismatic.
I prefer Malcolm X as a political figure, actually.
Yeah?
Yeah.
Oh, we can talk about that over.
But most people don't recognize it. So, okay, what Dr. King said was, he got people involved in the vision. You know, that's it. He just said, this is how I see it. If you see it too, let's go. Wasn't a plan. It was just a vision. I see it where people are equal and children can play together and all that kind of stuff. And that's it. Was a common cause. So, be giver. I think I'm radically running out of time. So, the next principle is be a giver. Okay? A lot of business sometimes is running what we can take out of it. However, if you want to be liked, what you have to remember is that every single person in the world is pretty much like a 12-year-old, right? When we write copy for the web, we write for a smart 12-year-old. Emotionally, most of us never get past our early teens. Sorry.
That's not what you can do for your country, what the country can do for you, what you can do for your country.
Or your customer, yeah, exactly. So, if you think about what kids like presents. I like presents. You probably like presents. Yeah, exactly. Yeah. The sparklier the better. Score. So be the giver. Be in a relationship. Be the. I was going to say feeder. That's a different talk. be the nourisher. You know, there was something Will and Grace a while back. In every relationship, there is a gardener and a flower. Don't be afraid to be the gardener. Yeah, because. Flowers like and need gardeners. So, pay attention. I say this really, really clearly, because it, you do pay attention. But what do you pay attention for? You pay attention for regard. Yeah? You spend your attention so you can get closer to somebody. Yeah? And it's an investment. So, by doing business on purpose, you pay attention, you acknowledge, you appreciate, you ask for advice. Yeah? If things are going down, if you know, kind of things are struggling, if you know, market's kind of tanking a little bit, acknowledge it. Ring your customers. Hiya. See, things are a little bit shit for you guys at the moment. Is there anything I can do to help? Yeah? Doesn't cost you anything. They're probably going to say no. But they remember. You'll make them feel cared for. Right? Acknowledge what they're doing. Appreciate the situation they're in. And then go, is there anything I can do? What can I do for you? Is there anything I can do for the area that you work in? And that's just, to be right, you have to make a connection. Right? And this is what you do. Pay attention. And do business on purpose. You may end up a better person by all of this, by the way. Accidentally, you may end up a much nicer person by the end of this thing. So, I was reading something about memories the other day, and when we encode memories, as well as sensory information, as well as the kind of, it was sunny, it was raining, it was this, that, it was kind of, I was in a building, we also encode the emotional state. Right, so memories are not emotionless. Again, do business on purpose. What kind of memories are people creating about you? Maya Angelou, which we kind of touched on last week, said that people forget what you said or what you did, but they'll never forget about the way you make them feel. And that's because it's encoding emotional state as well as the memory. So what memories are you helping them create? Because that's about doing it on purpose. Yeah, you're creating an experience, you're creating an environment. So, sorry.
Thank you. Just as I pressed.
So, what are you doing? Deliberately speaking, what are you doing? What are you giving? You know, what are you giving? In the experience of working with you, what are you giving? What are you bringing? It's like, I'm bringing a very, you know, I'm kind of bringing this, I'm giving it to you. Yeah, and I'm hoping that you're enjoying it. And what I'm hoping is that we'll use this to build a relationship. Then when I have got something else to launch, I'll come and talk to you guys again because I can trust your opinion. Because we know each other. There's a relationship. So, the two golden rules. There's not much time left now. So, is all this making sense? Is it? Can you see how you might use this to... I know it's not buttons that you guys were hoping for. It's like, this is the content route to happiness. These are the principles. If you use these principles, I guarantee people will like what you're doing. You just need to find a brand. Shoot me last week. Oh, damn the M6. But if you had a brand, you would be able to smash this. So, the two golden rules. This is what stitches them all together. Question. Familiarity breeds.
Familiarity.
It's not a trick question.
Trust.
Familiarity breeds trust, content. What did you say, David?
Familiarity.
Familiarity. Familiarity breeds familiarity. Interesting. Zen approach. So, okay. Any more for anymore? You're expecting a trick, I can feel it. There's no trick. So, familiarity breeds. Okay. The usual thing is
expectation.
Contempt. Yeah? The saying is familiarity breeds contempt. In that, if we've seen something 5, 10, 100,000 times before, we get bored with it. Yes? I will take your argument and trump you with Bruce Willis. Right?
5 times.
Yeah, exactly. How many times gets his vest on, gets... The Die Hard movies, they're great. Does everybody like Die Hard movies?
Absolutely.
Get out!
Second one's my favourite.
They're funny, they're exciting. No, because they're funny. He's, the thing is with Bruce Willis, he doesn't take himself very seriously at all. At all. And I've been thinking about writing the kind of Die Hard Guide to Business Planning, which I think I'm definitely going to do now. But
anticipation. Anticipation.
Exactly. Familiarity, you can't breed anticipation. But what I'm saying is that there's been 5 of these, And I literally could watch them over and over and over again because they're funny. Yeah? And I know what's going to happen, and there's some in jokes. Zoolander, in the film Zoolander.
You haven't lived.
Zoolander is the funniest film ever made.
Yeah.
Without a shadow of a doubt. Because I've watched it about 150 times, and every time I watch it, it gets funnier. Because you pick something else out of the background, or somebody else does something. Great.
The MacBook seems my favourite.
What?
The Mac.
Oh, right. The bit where the cat, yeah.
Favourite.
So,
just his face throughout. Brilliant.
Yeah, exactly. And they're all the same.
Yeah.
That's the thing. This is the Tigra. This is, yeah. Brilliant. Love it.
My favourite. Okay. My favourite.
Exactly. Rocky. You finally seen the film. Fantastic. Was the goat a fan?
My personal trainer, you see the pictures, he actually trained me to Rocky music when he really wants to push me. And when he puts the Rocky music on, I'm like, great.
Rightly so, you have to go for that. But like I say, Rocky, there's been six films works now. They're planning a seventh.
It's Creed. It's going to be awesome. Creed. I can't wait for it.
Yeah, yeah. There's a seventh. For those non-blokey people in Glee, right?
I love Glee.
Right.
I'm a Gleek.
Okay. Glee is a does everybody know what Glee is, right? Yeah? Glee's a programme which is fundamentally extremely expensively staged karaoke. Right?
This was you in your youth.
It really wasn't. Trust me, it really wasn't. But they're not singing new songs, they're singing covers. Yeah? So, you've heard them all a thousand times before, and yet we still watch it. So, and Henry Ford once said that if you had asked people what they wanted, they would have said faster horses rather than cars, right? Because familiarity actually breeds comfort and trust, right? If we know something, we get comfortable with it. And if we're comfortable with it, we start to trust it. Yeah, this is kind of leading on to next week. So one of the key things about it, one of the golden rules about being liked is being familiar. Yeah? If people know you and they consistently get to see you and they have a relationship with you over time, they start to trust you, they start to feel comfortable with you, and they start to believe what you're saying. Yeah? So this kind of bit of familiarity breeds contempt is vastly, vastly wrong. So when you're thinking about how you're gonna plan your social, or when you're planning an SEM campaign, or when you're planning you have to be really clear about how you're going to build familiarity in there. It's like the Old Spice adverts,
yeah.
Terry Crews.
He's brilliant.
Google them when you get home. They're starting off as one thing, and because people are so familiar with the whole, "Hi, I'm the man your men would smell like." Now it's Terry Crews going, you know who Terry Crews is, right?
He's going nuts.
Giant black dude, massive, like ripped, huge, humongous fella. And he's just going nuts, like smashing into other people. We're now so smashing into other people's adverts. Because you're familiar with the character, they can take you on a journey. You'll trust them. So, ways you can use this, some tools for building up familiarity with people. And basically doing a little bit of data mining. And Google Alerts are really good. You can set alerts for industry terms, people, events, things like that. And then when they happen, it pings. It literally sends you an email saying, this happened and these people are doing it. So if you're looking at book launches or such and such, or you know, that kind of thing, you could just tell it to tell me when this happens in this area and it'll ping up. There's a piece of software called Mention, which is a paid-for product, but you get one search for free. Obviously, I'm searching my own name constantly. It's really interesting what shows up. There are many famous Neil Simpsons, many, rather annoyingly. British middleweight boxing champion about 10 years ago was called Neil Simpson. Can play for Aberdeen, Neil Simpson. Guy, Ghostwriter, Gordon Brown, Gordon, what's his face, Ramsay's. Ghostwriter Gordon Ramsay's memoirs. He's called Neil Simpson. Architect Neil Simpson. I'm not the most famous Neil Simpson. That's annoying. Not
you are to us.
Not even the most famous Neil Simpson. I hate that.
You are to us.
Yeah. So what I do with these is I kind of set terms that I want to find out more about. Say, for instance, I want to target architects, for instance. Or if I, one of my clients is a PR company that specializes in architects, so I kind of, you know, I've got a lot of alerts for that kind of thing, about things where architectural projects go wrong, because we can go, we can fix that. Yeah. So I've got alerts going when there's planning complaints, or when buildings collapse, or when projects go awry. Then what I do is I kind of go, we can help fix it with through the power of PR, we can help you fix that. But without me knowing that they're happening, I wouldn't be able to target that. Yeah? So I set a Google alert for that. Also, if I'm building up information, that, does everybody here have a CRM?
What's that?
A customer relationship management system. Where
Excel spreadsheet.
Yeah.
Okay. Then no, you don't. You have a sales spreadsheet. Okay. So I use a thing called HubSpot. It's free. And HubSpot do a lot of the work for you. Because if you combine it with Sidekick, and Sidekick's a great thing, it's free. And it tells you when people are opening your emails, which is well handy. So, for instance, I was
using that today, actually.
It's really good. So when you're kind of when I was pitching this particular business, I knew they were interested because I saw the MD had opened my email 9 times in 25 minutes. You're on the hook there at that point, so I'm just waiting and I'll send him something tomorrow. If I hadn't, because he didn't tell me he was reading, so but by that little bit of software, I know what he's doing. Handy. So Sidekick's really good, and other social, Twitter for listening, all that kind of stuff. But what HubSpot does is, it's really good. It's a CRM, you can send mail through it, you can keep notes on it, you can do all kinds of stuff, and it also does a little bit of research.
Does it link in with Outlook?
I don't use Outlook, so I don't know.
I think it does online, but not for the standalone client version.
I use everything through the cloud anyway, so. It works with Google, worked very well with Google actually. So these are the tools I use to just kind of build a little bit of familiarity, because birthdays, information, like that. Yes.
Can you just give me an example? Give me a thread of how you would use those different things.
How
in your way.
Okay. Well, Neil, my architecture PR client, I noticed that he was doing quite a lot of whining about his social media, on social media, about not seeing that he was doing a lot of commenting on other people's posts. And I had a Google alert set up called Social Media Moans, where if certain keywords were mentioned, they would pop up and I could go, oh, comment on that, fantastic, look, I'll fix that for you. So I know when this is happening, yeah? So, then I've added him onto as a kind of prospect onto my CRM, and then I could do a little bit more research with him. So every time I set up a little thing of a mention, so every time he popped up, every time he mentioned something, every time he was written about in something else, like one of his clients, he would pop up so I could kind of see what he was doing. Okay, right, he works with £2 to £5 million building companies and architecture companies, and he does this, blah, blah, which tells me how to approach him. Yeah. So I put together some email. I put together a bit of an email campaign where I go, okay, I notice you're a PR company. I notice that you're struggling with social media. I notice that your clients are such and such and such and such. Obviously, you have this brand value, that brand value, like prestige, kind of grown up, notice that kind of thing. I can help you triple your audience while maintaining your brand values and also get leads and conversions. Do that. By using Sidekick, I'd see that it's opened it 9 times, so blah, 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 blah. So then what I do is then I call him, knowing fine well he's opened it. I was just wondering what you thought about the email. He goes, would you like to chat? You know what I mean? It's like magic. Yeah? And now I kind of keep an eye on him, so I know he's not being too much of a dick with other social media. Because if I'm doing it for him and he's still moaning, that's not very good of me, is it? Yeah.
Does Sidekick know that for sure he's opened it, only that he's opened it and it's downloaded something to display to him?
No, that he's opened it and read it.
So it knows for sure.
You can see that they've opened it and clicked on something in it, opened it and sent it somewhere, opened it. It's pretty good. Try it out. It's free. It's a free bit of software. And you get up to 200 mails a month. I only really use the Sidekick ones for people I don't know very well or important emails, so I know that people open. That makes sense. Okay. I just want to get more familiar with them, because if I understand them, A, I understand whether they're a good fit for me, and B, I know where I have to put the information so that they can become familiar with me. Mm-hmm. Yeah. So, the final secret to being liked. I know the tension is palpable. Patience.
Oh, no.
Sauce. Bugger. Patience. This is the thing, is that very rarely do people like you overnight. Yeah? And if you want to build a trusting relationship with people, that happens over time. If you think about farming, a farmer plants many seeds. Many, many seeds. And not all of them grow. Just over 50%, roughly. Yeah? And not only that, they plant a lot of seeds. Half of them don't grow, and they have to wait 7 or 8 months to get the comeback. Patience is invaluable. Yeah? However, when they do get it back, it comes, you know, bounty is enormous. Yeah? It's patience and time. If you keep planting seeds, if you keep kind of farming it, you keep farming your business, you're going to get some results. It may take a little longer than you expect, but it will come, I promise you. The question you need to ask yourself is, what seeds are you guys planting every day? Every day. Are you sending, you know, are you kind of posting something? Are you kind of connecting with somebody? Are you reaching out to somebody? Are you making phone calls instead of emails? Are you just thinking, oh, how does that work? Can we talk to you about that? Look at the difference it's made. Just a simple set of phone calls. Yeah? Makes a massive difference. So, thank you. Are there any questions? Thank you for that. Are there any questions about being liked? I know 2 hours is a bit of a long time. Are we all in the time? So, next week we're going to touch on how to get people to trust you. The four C's of trust, which I'm going to tell you next week. What people need before they can trust you. Because they need something from you first. Before they can trust you, and what trust enables you to do. So, it'll be same kind of format next week. Should we just strip to the waist and wrestle next week? That sounds
just the way.
No, good for that.
You're Oliver Reed moments pass you by, hasn't it?
More Oliver Reed shaped by the day, I find. good. So, thank you very much for listening. If anybody, are we talking afterwards?
Yeah.
Good.
We'll take it for dinner.
Kind of feedback sense, how was that? Did it make sense? Is it useful?
Awful.
Really
absolutely.
Really useful. Good.
Yeah. Yeah.
Okay. I was talking to the girls the other day about the mythical fifth session. Okay.
Mythical.
The mythical fifth session. Because it's a 4-stage process. No light trust bar. And I've kind of organised a fifth session. What I'd plan for the fifth session is to make it practical. So if you want to come in and make, to create practical stuff around marketing and do like work hands-on rather than just listen